Where am I? Is it this way? What am I? Should I go back this way, maybe? I'm completely lost. I can't recognize anywhere. Why do I look so different? I've lost my place now. Oh. Hello. I'm Thomas Telford. Nice to meet you. I'm trying to find somewhere, but I'm a bit lost. I'm trying to reach Pontcysyllte, you see. Pontcysyllte is a large and wonderful aqueduct. Do you know what an aqueduct is? Well, an aqueduct is a bridge that carries water, and it has 18 strong pillars holding it up. I designed Pontcysyllte, you see, me, Thomas Telford, and I returned because I heard a rumour that Pontcysyllte has been given a World Heritage status. My wonderful creation. World Heritage sites, like the Great Wall of China, Stonehenge, the Tower of London, and here in Wales, we have the castles of Edward I, Caernarfon, Beaumaris, Harlech, and Conwy. And down in South Wales, we have the famous ironworks of Blaen Avon. And these places are very famous and very important to the regions. And to think my creation is amongst them all. I'm so proud. So, I decided to rediscover Pontcysyllte today and to make sure it's still there, every bit of it. But I'll have to find it first. You see, everywhere and everything looks completely different to compare to when I was a young lad over 200 years ago. Things were very different many years ago. You had coal mines and slate quarries, ironworks and copperworks and woolen mills. And in the docks in Liverpool, you had huge ships, and these ships would transport goods to all corners of the world. There was a name for this period, the Industrial Revolution. Cyfnod y chwyldro diwydiannol. And another thing, to transport the goods to the docks, there were canals all over Wales. Do you know what a canal is? Well, a canal is a network of rivers built for narrow boats. It was a very noisy time. You had the noise of trains on the tracks, and then the explosions of the rocks in the quarries, and then the busy docks, ahoy, ahoy, and then the whizzing and whirling of the woolen mills. It was a time of great change, and I contributed a lot towards that change. How about I share a bit of my life story with you? I was born in 1757 in Dumfries, Scotland, a son of a shepherd, but my father died when I was only a few months old, so I was raised by my mother. We were very poor, and because we were poor, I had to find work at a very young age. So, when I was 14, I started working as a stonemason's apprentice. A stonemason is someone who cuts and then shapes stone, and then builds with them. So, a sort of a builder, but a very skillful one. So, instead of being in school when I was 14 years old, I was out working with my hammer and chisel. And then, in my spare time, I used to read, write, and learn. I had a big interest in designing and building things. I would dream of a design and then wake up suddenly and write it all down quickly. So building and design became my life. During my lifetime, I worked on 183 big projects, 93 bridges or aqueducts, 37 harbours or docks, 17 canals, more than 1,200 miles of road, 32 churches in Scotland, and one prison. And I'm happy to tell you that most of the things that I built are still standing, are still being used today. One of the famous bridges that I built is in North Wales, a bridge that crosses the Menai Straits and connects Bangor and Anglesey. The Menai Bridge. I'm so proud of this bridge, a masterpiece, just like Pontcysyllte. During the Industrial Revolution, things changed suddenly around the world. People started trading in goods such as coal, copper, iron, and slate. And here they are. These are core materials that were mined during the Industrial Revolution. I collected these on my way here today. And these can be found naturally in Wales. This copper has come from Amlwch on Anglesey. This coal from Blaen Avon in Gwent. And this iron from Merthyr Tydfil near Cardiff. And this slate from the Dinorwig quarry near Mount Snowdon. And I have little bits of Wales in my pocket. And these were transported to all parts of the world. But how would they be transported to the docks? Well, there were canals, trains, and horse and carts. But which one of these was the most popular? Well, every one of them, in turn. As demand grew for the materials to arrive quicker, well, another solution was needed because the canals were very slow. Then the trains appeared. The trains could carry 500 tons of coal at a time. Now then, the railway system was so effective and fast that by the end of the Industrial Revolution, they had completely taken over from the canal system. But I have a special place in my heart for the canals. Now, can you guess why? Well, of course, my creation, Pontcysyllte. Before I tell you how we built Pontcysyllte, why did we need to build it in the first place? Well, the problem was this. Wales isn't flat, and we had to find a way of transporting goods over the Dee River and valley. Now, a valley is like a big bowl. And to build the canal, well, basically you need a flat surface. You couldn't build a canal that goes down and up like a roller coaster. It'd be impossible. Now then, they needed someone to manage the project. No, not me, but my good friend, William Jessop. A very important man. Now, William Jessop was one of the best engineers in Britain at the time, and he was given the title Consultant Engineer. Now, someone was needed to help William Jessop. And yes, that was me, and I was given the grand title of General Agent, Surveyor, Engineer, Architect, and Overlooker of the Ellesmere Canal. That's some title. I was a very young man, only 36 years of age, and I didn't have any experience in building canals. So this was a turning point in my career. But I was glad that my good friend William Jessop was by my side. The task, therefore, was to build a path of water to carry narrow boats along the valley. Now then, we had many discussions, and I couldn't stop thinking of ideas, and then suddenly I had a brainwave. Bing! I thought we could do as the Romans did many years ago and build an aqueduct. Well, if the Romans could build an aqueduct over 2,000 years ago, well, surely we could do it as well. So I turned to my paper and pencil and assigned the answer to the problem, exactly as I would have done those years ago as a young lad. I was very proud of my design, but the public didn't have much faith in me or my design. And one evening, in a public meeting, I had to answer some difficult questions. The bridge will be ugly! I can assure you that the bridge will be stunningly beautiful. It will be too expensive, said another. Well, yes, it is a big project, and the cost will be £45,000, and that's about 3.5 million in today's money. But I can assure you that we will be attracting the wealthy people to contribute towards the cost. Will the bridge be safe? Oh, I can assure you, the bridge will be completely safe. It'll be strong enough to hold 1,500 tons of water and the boats carrying the materials. I had to work very hard to persuade the public that my design was going to work. And fortunately for me, William Jessop had complete faith in me, and the bridge was commissioned. On the 25th of July, 1795, the building work began. It took us 10 long years to build the bridge. The biggest bridge in the world to be built out of wrought iron. But you can never understand the enormity of Pontcysyllte. Nothing can compare to seeing it with your own eyes. Isn't she amazing? Look, and they're still there. 1, 2, 3, 18 pillars as strong as ever. And I can see a canal boat moving gracefully across it. The aqueduct is so high and so beautiful. I'm not surprised that it was awarded a World Heritage status. And now that you know the history, I hope you will also discover Pontcysyllte. Go there if you can. And think of me, Thomas Telford.